Building a dynasty in the NFL is extremely difficult. The amount of things that have to go your way make it almost impossible. So when that potential dynasty slips through your fingers, you better believe it stings. As we sit here about 6.5 years later, I'm sure there are still some Seattle Seahawks fans out there that still think about what happened on the 1-yard line during Super Bowl 49. When you look back and realize they were 1 yard away from back-to-back Super Bowl championships, Russell Wilson was still just 26 years old, a defense that finished number one in total defense in back-to-back years with many of their guys still in their prime, and the head coach in Pete Carroll, who at that point had all his guys bought in, and his defensive numbers spoke for themselves. Aside from the obvious Malcolm Butler play, where did it all go wrong? Why did a team with such promise and young stars never get back to the big game, or even the NFC Championship for that matter? With that said, we'll go back in time and try to figure that out. If you enjoyed this video, be sure to subscribe for more NFL content in the future, and let's get into it. After a heartbreaking Super Bowl loss in 2014 that once again would have given Seattle 2 straight championships, they had to figure out their roster construction with Russell Wilson and his contract extension looming. See, the biggest advantage an NFL team can have is a good quarterback on a rookie contract. As we know, it's a salary cap league, so when your quarterback is making around $5 million, sometimes less, as compared to a quarterback making over $30 million, it allows you to sign more free agents and have a better roster overall. Just look at what the Chiefs did when Patrick Mahomes was on his rookie deal, and look at Tom Brady and the Patriots when Tom Brady was taking pay cuts. When Seattle made their first 2 Super Bowl appearances, Wilson had been playing on his third-round rookie contract, which at that time was paying him an average salary of about $750,000. But the season after the Malcolm Butler play, Russ signed a 4-year, $87.6 million extension, now giving him an average salary of about $22 million per year. The competitive advantage was now gone, and now Seattle would have to trim off some of that cap space from their roster and proceed to compete on an even playing field. In the last couple years, Seattle already lost some guys like Golden Tate, Sidney Rice, Clinton McDonald, Brandon Browner, and Tony McDaniel. Now in 2015's offseason, they let go of Byron Maxwell, one of their starting cornerbacks, linebacker Malcolm Smith, who was the Super Bowl MVP in Super Bowl 48, electric wide receiver Percy Harvin, O'Brien Schofield, and they also traded their all-pro center Max Unger. They did add Frank Clark and Tyler Lockett in the draft though, which would end up helping down the line. Now the man they got back in the Max Unger trade was Saints tight end Jimmy Graham, who at that time was a top 2 tight end in football, no debate. In late November that season though, Graham tore his patellar tendon and was out the rest of the year, so the Seahawks' biggest receiving threat was off the field. They finished the regular season strong, winning 6 of their last 7, won in the wild card game in a thriller at Minnesota thanks to Blair Walsh, but then lost to the 15-1 Panthers team. That 2016 offseason, they lost some important pieces to their team. Running back Marshawn Lynch went into his short-lived retirement, left tackle Russell Okung signed with the Broncos, one of their better pass rushers Bruce Irvin went to Oakland, Brandon Mebane went to San Diego, and right guard J.R. Sweezy went to Tampa Bay. In 2016, Seattle went 10-5-1, winning the NFC West for the first time in 2 years. In the wild card round, they had a home game versus the Lions in which they won by a ton, and then it was on the face the Atlanta Falcons, who they did beat earlier that season, but that game was at home. This time though, it wasn't Atlanta, and they took care of Seattle pretty easily by a score of 36-20. Their free safety Earl Thomas broke his leg in early December, and they definitely missed him in this game as Matt Ryan had a great day against Seattle's secondary down a man. The 2017 offseason for the Seahawks kind of seemed like their last year of being all in to win a Super Bowl. I will explain why in a second, but Seattle did not lose many guys that offseason, which was the good news, and they signed guys like Eddie Lacy, Bradley McDougal, Shaquille Griffin in the draft, and oh yeah, that Blair Walsh guy who we mentioned earlier. Anyway, I called this their last season of being all in because this season would be followed by an unexpected Cam Chancellor retirement, which was a huge loss, as well as losing their veteran pass rusher Michael Bennett via trade, who was their best defensive end. They did trade for talented defensive lineman Sheldon Richardson from the Jets, but that would only end up being a 1-year rental. In 2017, Seattle started 8-4, and it looked like they had themselves a playoff appearance for their 6th straight year, but a December collapse going 1-3 to end the season had them missing the postseason for the first time in the Russell Wilson era. Not only was Cam Chancellor lost for the year, but cornerback Richard Sherman also tore his Achilles in the middle of the season. Sherman and Chancellor had been some of the main guys headlining Seattle's Legion of Boom secondary, and this unfortunately was the last time we would see all 3 guys play together. They did make a midseason trade that year for left tackle Dwayne Brown from the Texans, which still goes down as an awesome trade, but Russell Wilson continues to get sacked a ton of times despite that. And one of the issues with a quarterback getting big money is now you don't have the cap space to pay some high-priced offensive linemen, which is something Russell Wilson has realized and has grown tired of in recent years. But in that 2018 offseason, Seattle lost Cam Chancellor to early retirement, defensive end Michael Bennett was traded to the Philadelphia Philadelphia Eagles for not much. They lost Paul Richardson, Cliff Averill, Sheldon Richardson, Jimmy Graham, who they once made a big trade for, and lastly, another massive piece of this team releasing cornerback Richard Sherman, who had been there for a long time and has been their best defensive player, arguably. Sherman was released, and with him entering his 30s and coming back from an Achilles injury, it all seemed logical, but at the end of the day, it was an end to an era for once the best defense in football. Some pretty key losses, but they tried to make up for it by adding Barkevious Mingo, Ed Dixon, Jerome Brown, DJ Fluker, and their old friend Byron Maxwell. Based on those roster downgrades, you would think Seattle got worse, but they actually improved by a game, going 10-6. The last remaining member of the Legion of Boom ended his Seahawks career by flipping off his own coach, Pete Carroll. Thomas broke his leg in week 4 of 2018, and after an ongoing contract dispute, he let out his frustration while being carted off. Thomas admitted over a year later that him and Pete Carroll have not spoke since the incident. Somehow, Seattle still kept it together defensively, ranking as the 11th best defense in football that season. It was some newer names making the impact, like Frank Clark, Trey Flowers, Shaquille Griffin, Justin Coleman, Jaron Reed, and of course, Bobby Wagner. Their offense did even better as Tyler Lockett finally broke out in year 4. The rushing attack was led by 7th rounder Chris Carson, and Russell Wilson was putting up MVP numbers. They did unfortunately lose in the wild card round at Dallas, putting an end to a season that had some promise. In 2019's offseason, they lost Doug Baldwin to once again a pretty early retirement, a guy that's been a very steady and solid receiver there for a long time. The last remaining member of the Legion of Boom, Earl Thomas, was signed by the Ravens. J.R. Sweezy left for a second time in his career, and the slot corner Justin Coleman signed with the Detroit Lions. They brought in guard Mike Iupati, K.J. Wright was re-signed, linebacker Michael Kendricks was brought back, and they signed kicker Jason Myers. These moves led to an 11-5 record in 2019, another playoff appearance, but yet another year where they could not get past the divisional round. That made it 5 straight seasons of not making it past the divisional round since the Malcolm Butler interception in 2014 Super Bowl. And then in 2020, they made it 6 straight seasons not getting past the divisional round, even coming off a 12-4 season. Even after trading multiple first round picks for stud safety Jamal Adams, it still was not enough. The Rams handled their business, running all over the Seahawks defense with Cam Akers and making Russell Wilson's life very difficult. And then in the coming months, news came out that Russell Wilson was frustrated with the Seahawks roster construction and wanted more say in personnel moves. Seattle has been in a weird spot for the past half decade. They are good enough to get 9-12 wins each year, mostly on the back of Russell Wilson, but the flaws on their roster always seem to show up in playoff time when it matters most. What they had in the early to mid 2010s was truly special and one of the most dominant defenses the NFL has ever seen, being quarterbacked by a former third round pick that was very easy to root for. And sure, maybe Richard Sherman, Earl Thomas, or Michael Bennett rubbed people the wrong way, but there's no denying how great this team was at one point. But where did the downfall actually happen? Was it the simple fact that they could not get over the interception on the 1 yard line? Did some players on the Seahawks roster lose confidence and question their coaches after such an egregious call was made? According to Cliff Averill, some players on Seattle started to question Pete Carroll ever since that passing play was called on the 1 yard line. But that's not the only thing that kept this franchise stagnant. Years of bad drafting, bad timing on injuries, salary cap restrictions, and guys getting older played a part as well. And speaking of drafting, this team went on an insane run of finding gems late in the draft. Cam Chancellor was a 5th round pick, Walter Thurman was a 4th round pick, Richard Sherman was a 5th round pick, Byron Maxwell a 6th round pick, the Super Bowl MVP Malcolm Smith was a 7th round pick, K.J. Wright in round 4, and even guys like Russell Wilson in round 3 and Bobby Wagner in round 2. But what if Seattle won that 2014 Super Bowl? Do they keep faith in Carroll and go on to win another 1 or 2 championships? It's a possibility, but we'll never know. As long as you have Russell Wilson playing at this level, your Super Bowl window is not entirely closed, but what else can this team do to get over the top? I personally have not seen much from the Seahawks this offseason to believe they improved much at all, but we'll see if they can change that in 2021. Hopefully you guys enjoyed this video. Once again, leave a like and subscribe if you enjoyed, and I'll talk to you guys next time.